You just returned from China. Tell me what's going on over there, because Economist magazine cover, the most powerful man in the world, Xi Jinping.
Well, I think there's a case to be made for that in terms of control at home, booming economy, and strategies that are aimed at expanding Chinese influence very broadly throughout Asia, Africa, and the Middle East. The whole One Belt, One Road initiative, to this $1 trillion initiative to build ports and airports and communication systems and railroads and so on all across Central Asia and in Southeast Asia, East Africa, right. And so on. So I think, you know, in military terms, that's not true. The United States president remains the strongest in the world in that respect. But in terms of power at home and sort of an expansive policy, I think you could make that case.
Do you make the case also based on the what's called the Thucydides principle, that when there is a rising power and established power, inevitably they end up in war?
I don't accept that inevitability. I'm familiar with the book that describes this trap, and I think that there is no geostrategic reason for the United States and China to be adversaries. Competitors, yes. Rivals, probably. But adversaries, I don't think so. But it requires careful management on both sides of the equation, on the Chinese side, on our side, to avoid it from heading in that direction.
Do you think the Chinese want to do that, that there is a commitment on their part to be as careful as they possibly can?
I think so. The last thing they need is a military conflict with the United States. Mm-hmm. They have a lot of issues at home. I mean, I talked about all the good things,
right,
powerful things for China, but they face a lot of problems at home, from the environment to this transition from a investment-based
right.
economy to a consumer-based one. You know, they've had as many people move from rural areas to the cities in the last 10 years as the entire populations of Britain, France, and Germany, 200 million people.
And in the history of civilization, more people have risen from poverty to the middle class.
Absolutely.
In China.
But the result of that is, I think that the party's only claim to legitimacy, it is certainly not communism as an ideology, but it is an improving standard of living for the Chinese people. And as long as the Chinese leaders can deliver that, they're probably safe. But that's the only basis of the legitimacy of the regime at this point.
But that was a very central point, I mean, in the 3.5-hour speech, the supremacy of the Communist Party.
Yeah. No, absolutely. And one of the things that Xi is doing is reestablishing discipline, both within the party, but also in terms of for those outside of party, companies, businesses, the population as a whole, and the military especially, is that the party is the be-all and end-all.
Second question, what do they think of us today?
I think that until 2008, they probably were envious of our sustained economic development and our economic model. And I think one of the things that a lot of people may not appreciate is the degree to which our financial crisis in 2008 and 2009 discredited our economic model in the eyes of a lot of
right.
people around the world. And that lingers. That is still there. So I think
because it had such repercussions around the world.
Absolutely. And I think they see the United States, I think they see some opportunities right now because we are so divided as a country and because our government is so divided. So it's very difficult for us to do big things, whether it's to fix our infrastructure or to have big foreign policy initiatives like they have underway. much less some of the other domestic issues. So they see our paralysis right now, I think, as providing some real opportunities.
In an interesting way, too, the last 15 or 20 years, you know, certainly Vietnam, but after Vietnam, Korean War, which they were engaged, I mean, before Vietnam, the Korean War, then Vietnam, and then we've been engaged in the Middle East. They haven't been engaged in the Middle East. You know, some people say, who won the Iraq War? Iran. Now, you've heard that. But some people say, while we've been mired down in Afghanistan and the Middle East in one way or the other, they have simply not had those distractions to focus on developing at home.
Well, they have been able to focus at home. And I think that one of the serious consequences of now having been at war for 16 years is that it has contributed to this sense of impatience and exhaustion on the part of the American people in terms of engagement internationally. And sort of a sense of why can't we focus on our problems here at home and not be so involved in the rest of the world? Why do we have all these troops around the world and so on? And why can't we begin to fix the very obvious problems that we see every day in this country? So I think that it's not so much that the Chinese see that we have been distracted by those wars, although it certainly has taken a lot of time and treasure and lives, but that it has really, I've always believed that the patience of American people for international engagement is very limited. And the only time we've been able to do it effectively is when we have effective presidential leadership, because the Americans are not instinctively internationalists. They really just want to tend their own garden, sure. if you will.
America's a good place.
And so I think and I've also been very leery about the use of force abroad, because not whenever we have to for our own national security, but presidents need to understand that there's a limited appetite in this country for sending troops into war.
Well, President Obama's understood that, didn't he?
I think he did. And
may have gone too far.
Part of the problem that I think we faced is that everybody, when we get into a war, everybody who's advising the president to do it always says it'll be really short. We'll get this done real quick, and then we'll be out of there. And more often than not, that's not the way it turns out. So I think the Chinese have been able to take advantage of this American impatience with international involvement to gain a march on us in a lot of places.
Have we lost respect around the world?
I think so. I think so. And I think for two reasons. First, what we've already talked about, the financial crisis in 2008, 2009. And I think second, our paralysis here at home.
You mean in Washington?
Yeah. And our inability politically to do anything big, to deal with our public schools, to deal with infrastructure, to deal with immigration. A whole host of issues, and just we can't get anything done. And so I think I spoke earlier of people questioning our economic model. I think there are a lot of people now around the world who are questioning our political model. You know, maybe the way the Americans do it isn't so hot because look at them. Mm-hmm. And maybe this kind of more authoritarian state capitalism that you see in Russia, that you see in China, that you see elsewhere,
where they get
maybe
things,
that's
yeah.
the way to go. And so I think.
So people around the world who are looking for a model, they say, well, look, let's look at the United States. They're in paralysis. Look at China. You know, they're in control.
They're expanding robustly. And look at all these thousands of miles of high-speed rail they've built and all the bridges and all of the airports. Look at the difference between LaGuardia Airport and the airport in Shanghai and so on. And they say, you know. So, I think this is not irrecoverable. Yeah. I think we can get back there, but only if we begin to fix our internal political problems.
Has Donald Trump done great damage to the American presidency?
Well, I think, first of all, I think he's identified something that political leaders in both parties either ignored or were ignorant of for a long time. And that was, there are a lot of people in this country that felt like the political elites were ignoring them and ignoring how close to the edge they are.
Right.
And how even those who were at the lower middle class, who felt they were just one firing from being homeless, a loss of a job, and I think he's grasped the disdain of those people for the elites, and the elites have brought them the crisis in 2008, 2009. The elites have brought them this political paralysis in Washington. I mean, this paralysis predated. Paralysis predated Donald Trump. So I think he's grasped a part of the country that has felt very neglected. I wish he were more of a unifier, of somebody who was trying to bring us together as a people. I think that's what we need now. I mean, we've had a lot of divisions in the United States ever since the beginning. Our politics have always been partisan, and nothing's been said in politics recently that was worse than what Adams and Jefferson said
exactly
about
right.
each other.
You don't believe
so,
it. Yeah, right.
So some things are a constant in American history, but this divisiveness that where even families now can't talk about politics because they're so divided around the dinner table, I think is a place we don't want to be as a country, and I would like to see him try and lead us out of that. I don't know if he can. We'll see.